नमस्कार। स्पिरिचुअल डॉक्टर्स फॉर होलिस्टिक हेल्थ पर आप सभी मित्रों का, दर्शकों का स्वागत है। प्लेटफॉर्म पर हम अलग अलग मेडिकल डॉक्टर्स को, एक्सपर्ट्स को बुलाते रहते हैं, जिनके माध्यम से हमें अपने हेल्थ को होलिस्टिक वे में, स्पिरिचुअल वे में जीने का समझ पैदा हो। और हेल्थ जो कहते हैं कि सोसाइटी के लेवल पर एक बर्डन है, इतने सारे लोगों के पास समस्याएं हैं, इतनी बीमारियां बढ़ रही हैं। समस्याओं का एंटीडॉट है नॉलेज। जितना नॉलेज हमारे पास प्रॉपर वे में, सिस्टमेटिक वे में हो, हमारे लिए स्वस्थ रहना, स्वस्थ जीना उतना आसान हो जाता है। स्पिरिचुअल डॉक्टर्स फॉर होलिस्टिक हेल्थ जब हमने शुरू किया, मेरे मेरे जेहन में था कि जो समाज में जिसको बड़ी बीमारी मानते हैं, कैंसर है, हार्ट डिजीज है, डायबिटीज है, उसके रिगार्डिंग हमारे सेशन सबसे अधिक सेशन हो, नॉलेज प्रॉपर आए और लोग डरना बंद करें कि अगर एज हो गई है तो बीमारी से सफर करना जरूरी ही है। हमारे प्लेटफॉर्म पर मेरठ से राहुल बंसल सर आए थे, जिन्होंने होलिस्टिक हेल्थ पर सेशन लिया था। हमारे पुराने स्पीकर, नमस्कार सर।
नमस्कार जी। नमस्कार।
आपका चैनल मैं देखता रहता हूं, आप काफी अच्छा काम कर रहे हैं।
सब प्रभु की कृपा है। आप भी प्रभु प्रेरणा से कर रहे हैं, मैं भी कर रहा हूँ। हम सभी उन्हीं के ही चेले हैं, भगवान के।
जी सर, तो आपके माध्यम से हमें मनचंदा सर से संपर्क हुआ, धन्यवाद आपका। और डॉक्टर मनचंदा सर जैसे सीनियर डॉक्टर हमारे प्लेटफॉर्म पर जुड़ रहे हैं, यह हमारे लिए भी एक गर्व की बात है।
बहुत
उनका प्रोफाइल जब मैंने पढ़ा, पबमेड में आर्टिकल पब्लिश हुए हुए हैं, 300 से अधिक आर्टिकल, कार्डियोलॉजी पर 4 बुक। तो एक रिसर्चर, सिर्फ डॉक्टर ही नहीं, इस तरह रिसर्चर भी हैं और अनुभवी लोगों का अगर मार्गदर्शन हमें मिले तो जरूर हम लोग एक स्वस्थ जीवन जीना सीखेंगे। तो बंसल सर, थोड़ा आप ही सर का परिचय दें आप।
देखिए, मनचंदा साहब को परिचय देना सूर्य को दिया दिखाने जैसा है। वो ना केवल एक भारत के एक सीनियर मोस्ट कार्डियोलॉजिस्ट हैं, बट वो ऐसे डॉक्टर हैं एम्स जैसी संस्था में शीर्ष पद पे रहते हुए, HOD, इन्होंने योग को, होलिस्टिक को मेन स्ट्रीम में लाने में इनका बहुत बड़ा योगदान है। इनका बायोडाटा तो आप बता ही चुके हैं, उसमें तो बहुत समय लगेगा। पब्लिकेशन है और इनको अवार्ड्स भी बहुत, पद्मश्री तो है ही इनका, और भी बहुत सारे अवार्ड्स हैं। मगर उससे भी बड़ी बात यह, इन्होंने उस समय देश में होलिस्टिक और योगिक लाइफस्टाइल की बात करनी शुरू करी, जब ये बात करना कम से कम भारत में किसी की ज्यादा हिम्मत नहीं थी, मतलब इतने जोर शोर से। इन्होंने साइंटिफिकली डी नॉर्निश से भी बड़ी स्टडी करके रिवर्सल ऑफ हार्ट डिजीज को प्रूव किया, अपना जो इनका सेंटर है छतरपुर मंदिर के पास, और इन्होंने उसका प्रचार किया। मैं भी इनके संपर्क में जब आया, क्योंकि मैं भी थोड़ा बहुत गुरुदेव की प्रेरणा से होलिस्टिक के उसमें जाता था, मैं देखता था हर जगह मनचंदा साहब जरूर होते हैं और बहुत मनोयोग से, बड़े प्रेम से साइंटिफिकली बताते हैं। तो मुझे लगा कि ये व्यक्ति ऋषि तुल्य हैं, मैं इनको मेडिकल ऋषि कहता हूं। इतने बड़े उस पर रह के इन्होंने अब ये खुलेआम कहने लगे हैं योगिक लाइफस्टाइल इज द बेस्ट प्रिवेंशन अगेंस्ट कॉरोनरी हार्ट डिजीज एंड अदर रिलेटेड नॉन कम्युनिकेबल डिजीजेस। ये इस तरह से कहना एकदम साइंटिफिकली डंके की चोट पे, ये हर एक की हिम्मत नहीं है, क्योंकि आप जानते हैं ज्यादातर डॉक्टर्स में ना तो एक करेज होता है, ना उनकी इच्छा शक्ति होती है, ना उनके पास साइंटिफिक बैकग्राउंड होता है। सर के पास तीनों हैं। तो उसी सिलसिले में मैं संपर्क में आया, इनका मैंने सुना, और हर बार मैं सुनता हूँ, कितनी बार सुन चुका हूँ, मेरा मन नहीं भरता। आज भी मैं उतना ही उत्सुक हूँ क्योंकि हर बार कुछ ना कुछ नया बताते हैं। सुभारती मेडिकल कॉलेज जिसमें मैं हूँ वहां भी हमने इनको दो बार आमंत्रित किया है व्याख्यान के लिए। हर बार हमारे प्रोफेसर, हमारे मेडिकल स्टूडेंट्स इतने प्रसन्न होते हैं, मुझसे हर बार पूछते हैं आगे कब बुलाओगे आप, अगली बार कब बुलाओगे। तो इस आयु में भी सर 80 प्लस हैं, इनकी जो ऊर्जा है, इनका जो ज्ञान है और इनकी जो क्लैरिटी ऑफ थॉट्स है, मैं मुझे कहने में कोई चक नहीं है। आई नो वेरी फ्यू कार्डियोलॉजिस्ट, वेरी फ्यू, हार्डली एनी, जो इस तरह का ज्ञान, होलिस्टिक विजन और ओपननेस रखते हैं। तो मैं बहुत आपको बधाई देता हूं रंजन जी कि आपने ये बहुत अच्छा एक वो किया, और निश्चित रूप से आपके माध्यम से, आपके चैनल के ये बात और लोगों तक पहुंचेगी, बहुत सबका भला होगा। ये संक्षेप में मैं इतना ही कह सकता हूं सर के बारे में।
धन्यवाद सर। मनचंदा सर से अब प्रार्थना है कि अब वो अपनी बात आज हमें एजुकेट करें रिगार्डिंग प्रिवेंशन ऑफ हार्ट डिजीज बाय हेल्दी लाइफस्टाइल। वेलकम सर।
थैंक यू वेरी मच। मैं अगर अपनी स्लाइड्स को लोड कर लूं। गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, इट्स अ रियल प्लेजर टू टॉक इन फ्रंट ऑफ डॉक्टर्स फॉर होलिस्टिक हेल्थ, बिकॉज होलिस्टिक हेल्थ इज समथिंग व्हिच इज नाउ कमिंग अप वेरी स्ट्रॉन्गली इन द मेडिकल प्रोफेशन। आई हैव बीन प्रैक्टिसिंग इन मेडिकल प्रोफेशन फॉर द लास्ट मोर देन 50 ईयर्स, and from the Western system we have really gone on now to the holistic system, which means that we should not only use the latest advances in medical science but also combine it with so-called our ancient wisdom, and the results are extremely fantastic because in spite of all the advances in the medical field, like in the field of heart disease, we have been able to do angioplasties, we can do bypass, we can do transplant and so many other procedures. But in spite of all that, the heart disease is really increasing. And therefore, even WHO has said that the reason why we have failed to control this is because we have not used the holistic system. So today I'm going to talk about this biggest killer of mankind, that is heart disease. This is what I'm going to talk is not only true for heart disease, but other non-communicable diseases, which are the leading cause of death. As you know, communicable diseases have decreased in our country, but the so-called non-communicable diseases, out of which heart disease is the top, then diabetes is there, hypertension, and so many other diseases like anxiety, depression are there. Well, as you know, medical science has always claimed to have increased the life expectancy. And it is estimated that the life expectancy has really increased by more than 10 years in the last few years. It may be more, but this is a little old slide. So what is the reason for this increase in the life expectancy? And it is the cardiology which has contributed to most of this prolongation of life. 7 of these 10 years are contributed by cardiology, because we are able to tackle these heart diseases better. Now, out of cardiology, which is the biggest contribution? The biggest contribution is more than 50% of lifestyle. This they have written 50%, I put it 70%, because that is by exercise, diet, tobacco cessation. And if you add stress, maybe it'll be 70 to 80%. And then the rest 40% because of drugs, medicines that we use, blood thinning medicines, antiplatelets, beta blockers, these inhibitors, ARNI, etc., statins. Now, so you can see that 90% of the reason why cardiology has contributed is just medical treatment. It's mostly the prevention, either primary or secondary. And we talk a lot about bypass surgery and angioplasty. It has contributed only 10%. And now, as you know, that angioplasty is only prescribed in patients who have heart attacks. It's extremely useful. I'm not against it. And coronary bypass is done when patients' angina cannot be controlled. So all these interventions are so costly, have contributed very little. And we talk of cancer, etc., it has contributed very little, 2.4 months. I'm not against cancer research, but as you can see that it has not really contributed significantly. So it is mostly the cardiology, mostly the lifestyle. And as you know that heart diseases are lifestyle related diseases, and there are four factors in lifestyle which I think we should talk. If we can change them, the disease can come down significantly. It has much more effect, as you know, a slight change in diet, decrease in tobacco consumption, exercise, and mental stress. If they can be controlled, heart disease could come down significantly. I'll talk about some of the evidence which is available in all these four, but my emphasis will be on mental stress, because in the conventional medical literature, that is the Western literature, mental stress is not given due importance, and that is very, very important. There is another factor which is not in our control called atmospheric pollution, which is very important for our country also, because it is contributing to at least 7 lakh deaths every year due to heart disease as well as lung disease. So fifth cause is not under our control. Now let's talk about the diet. As I said, in spite of all the advances, the heart disease is increasing. This is quite true, and this has been now clearly shown in many studies that deaths due to heart disease are increasing in developing countries like India. In some countries they have decreased, in the United States, etc. But in India they are increasing. Now let's talk about the diet. Now there is a complete mismatch of our modern diet and lifestyle. As you know, for 2.5 million years, man has been eating what is called as natural food, the food which is available from the nature. That means, and in the last about 70, 80 years, the food has changed. How has it changed? We have started refining the food. This refined food is extremely dangerous. For example, we have refined jaggery or gur into sugar, and I'll show you how bad it is. We have wheat, we have done into white flour or called maida. And the third thing, we have even refined rice, which becomes bad. And fourthly, we have refined oils, which have become bad. So in the last 100 years, our diet has completely changed. It was not from the nature. We have started making ourselves. And that is the cause for the disease, not only diabetes, obesity. And in addition, of course, we have these electronic gadgets, which we are spending a lot of time, especially in this COVID time, people are spending a lot of time. They put on a lot of weight, etc. It has been shown that 2 hours of sitting in front of the television, if you watch more than 2 hours, the disease chances increases by 10% or so. So too much of spending time in front of these electronic gadgets is really bad for us. Even sitting for a long period is bad. We should really be standing. Even standing is better than sitting. So I'll come to that in a minute. Now, what about the diet? Well, there is a huge study which is called Global Burden of Heart Disease by WHO. And this has been published very recently in the very prestigious journal called Lancet. And they have calculated that in more than 190 countries, unhealthy diet is the biggest risk factor globally. So we are taking unhealthy diet, and most of the people are taking unhealthy diet, unfortunately. Nobody is really taking a healthy diet, and I'll tell you what healthy diet is. Now, unhealthy diet accounts for 11 million deaths. 1.1 crore people die. And this is the calculation they have done. And this is 20%. And mostly it is the cardiovascular disease. And it also has a lot of disability, 255 million disability life years. So it's the major cause of death. 20% of the deaths just occur because of unhealthy diet. And there are three factors. There are several factors which are associated with the increase in deaths. So if we can control only these three factors, the disease could come down by more than 50%. That is high intake of sodium. We take too much of salt. If we can lessen salt by 25%, the heart disease will come down by 25%. There's a huge mission of WHO to decrease sodium intake by 25% by 2025. And they believe with sodium decrease, the blood pressure will come down, and similarly, heart disease will come down. So we should not take extra sodium. Then low intake of whole grains. See, we are taking refined grains. As I said, everything is refined, like the rice and other grains. So if we take whole grains in ample quantity, this is the way nature has given us. We don't refine them, the heart disease could come down. And low intake of fruits. We vegetarians get less heart disease, but one of the reasons why Indians get heart disease in excess, one of the main factors is lack of fruits and vegetables. This has been shown in other studies called Interheart study, which was done in 52 countries to see why heart attacks occur, and lack of intake of fruits and vegetables. Any fruit can be taken, which is seasonal. Even cheap fruits are as good as the costly ones. Actually, the costly fruits which you see in the market, which are imported, which have stickers on them, are actually useless, because it should be fresh. These imported fruits are, you know, plucked 3 months earlier, they're kept in cold storage, and then artificially ripe. They have no food value at all. And the natural fruits, which are often fresh fruits and vegetables, they are good because they have fiber. They have a lot of other phytochemicals which can decrease cholesterol. So fruits can not only decrease heart disease, they can decrease, of course, hypertension, they can decrease even diabetes, and they can decrease cancer. So fruits and vegetables should be taken. There are other factors also, which I will talk about. So what should be eaten? It is a whole grains. Don't use refined grains, especially rice should not be white rice. It's a huge study called Pure Study, which has shown that, and again, more than 100 countries, white rice causes heart disease, hypertension, and of course, diabetes and also. White rice is bad. You should use brown rice and you should use legumes, which are again available in nature. Natural food we are talking about. Fresh fruits and vegetables should be taken. The Americans say 5 times, but at least I say 3 times a day. We did a study in All India Institute in which we showed that Indians take little fruit, and if they can increase it, they can decrease the incidence of heart disease significantly. Not only heart disease, even cancer, and even diabetes and hypertension. Fish can be taken if you want, but I think the fish in India is really not very good, because as you might have read, it's formalin and all. And the way it is transported is in the wagons, if you see, they stink. They are supposed to be at 4 degrees, but they are in room temperature. So a fish, although theoretically good, it has omega-3, I would not suggest at all. To fulfill this, we have to take other sources of omega-3. Omega-3 is a good fat. It is found in mustard oil. I will show you, this is the best oil, and which is unrefined. Again, it should not be refined oil. As I show you, refined oil is quite bad. Even ghee is very good. We used to earlier say that ghee is bad, but now it has been shown fat is not responsible for heart disease. It is the refined foods. I will show you a lot of data that fats really, if you take too little, you can get more heart disease. You know? So fats are, only one fat is bad, that is called trans fats, which is found in vanaspati ghee and refined. And one should avoid that. Most of the market food that you get is from trans fats. So trans fats are bad, but this ghee is not bad at all. Nuts are extremely good. It can be cheap nuts. You can have almonds. You can have walnuts. You can have peanuts. All those nuts are good. And even cashew nuts are good. People are scared. I have seen doctors saying, don't take cashew nuts as cholesterol. The cholesterol is zero in cashew nuts, and data is there to show that cashew nuts also have anti-atherosclerotic properties. Then Mediterranean or vegetarian diet. Mediterranean diet is one which is fruits and vegetables and all. It has been shown that this is extremely useful for prevention of heart disease. And similarly, a vegetarian diet. Data is there, Mediterranean diet and a vegetarian diet have similar effects. So we should take vegetarian diet. A lot of data is that vegetarians have less heart disease because the vegetarian diet has a lot of fiber, it has a lot of phytochemicals. They are lean, they also have less cancer and so on. So it's good to be vegetarian. God has made us vegetarian. And of course, some of the other things which are good in the food are green tea you should take. You can take coffee, 2-3 cups. There's no harm. Coffee we thought was bad. The data shows that coffee can is useful if you take in limited amounts. But green tea is equally good. Dark chocolates are good, but I don't encourage people to take chocolates because they have a lot of sugar and milk in there, and it should be low calories. Now, what should not be taken? Trans fats, as I said. Trans fats should not be taken because they can increase the cholesterol, and they can cause other disease like cancer. And trans fats are found only in vanaspati ghee, which is available in the market. Earlier, we used to use a lot of trans fats, but now people are aware. So oil they are using, we'll come to that. Sugar is the biggest culprit now. Sugar is considered the new cholesterol. And sugary drinks should be avoided. It has been shown that if you take Even one shubri drinks, the chances of heart disease increase by 10%. Of course, increases diabetes and blood pressure. Excess salt, I already said. So we should not take refined or processed foods. And these are the four things that are only refined. One is white rice, as I said, white bread, and refined oils. And similarly, we should not take white rice, brown rice. High GI food, we take all these mithais, Diwali is coming. So we should take a little food which has sugar in it. You can take healthy food which is made of jaggery or gur. That's not bad at all. There are some stuffs which are made. 100 years earlier, we used to have a lot of mithai, but it was not made of sugar. Sugar has been invented only last 100 years. So you can make healthy things. I think if the doctors insist, you can have healthy sweets also. We are not against sweets, but the sugar is the bad part. Red meat, of course, has been shown to be extremely harmful. Now, consensus is there that red meat not only causes heart disease, but also causes cancer. So red meat consumption has come down, especially which is processed. Fast food is bad because of many reasons. All of you know that. It is very full of refined food. It is full of fats. And they use a bad fat for trans fats, most of the things. Fried foods, reheated oil shouldn't be avoided. You know, all these sweet sellers, they use the oil again and again. If you reheat the oil, trans fats are produced. So one should not reheat the oils again and again, just once or twice. And high calories. Earlier, we thought dietary cholesterol is bad and saturated fats are bad, but it has been shown now dietary cholesterol really does not affect the cholesterol at all, because most 85% of the cholesterol is made by the liver. If you take high cholesterol, that means if you take the ghee or butter, which has a lot of cholesterol, or egg yellow portion, the liver will make less and it will not be affected much. And if you take less cholesterol, the liver will make more. So dietary cholesterol is not banned now. And saturated fats may not be harmful. As you will see, this is a huge study, which is called the PURE study, in which more than about 1.5 lakh individuals in 80 countries were followed for about 7.4 years. This is a study done by Dr. Saleem Yusuf and reported in a very prestigious journal. He is an Indian who is settled in Canada. And a large number of countries have involved in this, including the developing countries like India, because he is the one who talks mostly of the developing countries. Now, it was shown that it is not the fat, but it is the high carbohydrate intake, and that is refined carbohydrate. As I was telling you, it was associated with refined, for example, white rice and other refined food, as I showed you, like white bread, etc. So it is the biggest culprit is the high carbohydrate, and that is the refined carbohydrates. You can take non-refined carbo, like fruits, vegetables are also carbohydrates. The total fat, saturated and unsaturated fats were not related to risk of infarction or heart attack. And actually, if you take lower fats, you will get more disease, as I will show you. Higher saturated fats was associated with lower risk of disease. You see, these are the diagrams shown. You see the total mortality inversely related to the fat intake. So if you take less fat, you'll get higher mortality. And if you see the saturated fats, also there's a U-shaped curve. If you take too little, the mortality is increased. If you take too much, it's there. So you can take a optimal, even total calories really do not matter much. So at least we used to say you should take 30% from fats and all. You can take a little more also. So this is a huge study. Such study has never been done. It shows that fats are not responsible. If you see on the last column, what is responsible for increase in heart disease is the high carbohydrates. High carbohydrate means refined carbohydrates, because these developing countries, people were taking rice, it was white rice, and therefore they were not taking the whole grains, etc. So I think one should limit this. But when we say reduce carbohydrate, doesn't mean zero. Normally we take about 70%, you should reduce it to 50%. And if you use even more than 50%, it should not be refined carbo, as I said earlier. So there's another meta-analysis done that saturated fats may not be there. This also appeared in one of the very prestigious journals. So it was shown that the high intake of saturated fats are not responsible for heart disease. As you see, these are seven largest studies available in the literature. And this was reported in British Medical Journal that saturated fats may not be. Of course, trans fats, as I said, are extremely harmful and should not be taken. So saturated fats are not that bad. Of course, they are not come in the guidelines, but I'm sure they'll come soon. The cholesterol has already come out of the guidelines. Cholesterol may not cause it, but saturated fats and total fats will also be coming. These are trans fats are, of course, extremely harmful. And these are found, of course, as I said, in hydrogenated oils like vanaspati ghee, etc., which we use, or these halwais, reheating the oil again and again. So just if you replace 2% of trans fats by just 2% decrease, the heart disease can decrease by 53%. They're so bad. And one should avoid reheating and reuse of oil. Because reheating produces trans fats. A lot of question is that which is the best oil? There's so many oils available. Every company says that this is our good oil, whether it is the olive oil, whether it is sesame, whether it's rice bran, cotton seed. But if you see, this is a comparative diagram which I have taken. This is the only Indian data from Dr. Kapoor Nisa, who is the National Institute of Nutrition. She's the only one who has done a lot of work on fats. And as you see here, rapeseed or mustard oil, if you see, it has the lowest amount of saturated fats, 8%. As I said, it's not, but it has the highest amount of so-called omega-3 or ELNA, 10%, as compared to, there are two types of polyunsaturated. One is the N6 and N3. N3 are good. So it has the highest N3 or omega-3, 10 as against 12% of the omega-6. And the ratio is the best. According to WHO, we should have a ratio which should be close to 1 or 4:1. That is the best for prevention of heart disease. And this is the best, actually. The mustard oil that we use, it should be non-refined and all. Or rapeseed or canola, which is there, is the same thing. It is also, which is available in our country. That's equally good. Doesn't have the smell because uric acid is not there in the so-called rapeseed oil. Even ghee is very good. If you see, the ghee has a high amount of omega-3 fatty acids, and the ratio is good, 4, which WHO says is one of the best. Of course, ghee has saturated fats, but as I said, they are not too bad at all. Similarly, coconut has been considered as very bad in the Western country. But if you see here, coconut oil is used in our country. It has medium chain fatty acids, which are not bad. And there's a study done from India that coconut oil, even if you take in high amount, does not decrease it. Actually, ghee and coconut oil are extremely good for our country because they do not degrade during high temperature cooking. See, we fry the food, and for frying, we should have a stable oil, as I will show you. So, which is the best oil in Indian context? This is an editorial I wrote in Indian Heart Journal some years back. You can go and see. Indian cooking is different. It involves deep frying, that is, you have to heat it at a very long temperature. Certain oils, especially refined oils with high polyunsaturated fats, degrade easily to form compounds which are called free radicals, trans fats, and aldehydes. Now, these free radicals, trans fats, they can cause not only heart disease, they can also cause cancer. So if you reheat the oils, refined oil, you know, why refined oils are bad? Because for refining, you have to heat the oil twice. Once to take out the oil from the seeds, you have to heat it at about 300 degrees. And then secondly, to deodorize it, you heat it twice. So refined oils are already heated twice. And if you do it third time, you produce these. So there are reports that refined oils, if you do deep frying, can cause not only heart disease, but also cancer. Oils high in saturated fats are like ghee, coconut oil are excellent for deep frying. Of course, mustard oil is also very good. One should avoid reheating of oils as trans fats are produced. Like avoid refined oils as refining, as I said already, it involves high temperature twice and loss of antioxidants and toxic compounds like aldehydes are produced. So healthy cooking oil for Indian appears to be cold compressed mustard oil or ghee. So this we have been saying, I've been saying for 20 years, accepted now by almost all nutritionists. And why mustard oil is good? This is a very excellent study, which is published in American Journal of Clinical Nutrition. I think one of the best studies. This is a collaborative study between Harvard Medical School of Public Health, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, St. John Medical College, in 300 patients who had heart disease and 700 controls in 8 hospitals in India. And it was shown that the use of mustard oil was associated with a lower risk than sunflower oil. The risk was reduced by 71%. If you use mustard oil, it may be reduced by 71%. So there is evidence also. And the reason they were not clear, but they said because it has high omega-3 and it has low saturated fats. That's what they thought. But mustard oil has been clearly shown. There's only one problem with mustard oil. People think that it has uric acid, but maybe it's not allowed for cooking in the United States and United Kingdom. And the reason they say uric acid. The uric acid is clearly has been shown to cause cardiomyopathy in rats. Rats are deficient in oxidizing it. In monkeys and in man, no case of cardiomyopathy has been shown. So I think it's quite safe, and a lot of pressure is there on the governments in US and others to sanction it for eating. Although Indians are still eating it, although it is written mustard oil for external use. But mustard oil is one of the best oil. It should be non-refined, cold compressed. Even if you want to use other oils like olive oil, which is not bad, and similarly canola oil, which is nothing but rapeseed like mustard oil, they should be extra virgin. Extra virgin means they are not refined. So refined oils are not non-refined. Now, this is how did we come out with fruits and vegetables? This is a huge study, nurses health study, in which about 1.3 lakhs nurses were followed for 14 years. It was shown those who took fruits and vegetables frequently, as you can see, at the end of 10 years, they had 25% less heart attacks as compared to them. So this is a scientific evidence. Increased fruit and vegetable intake reduces cardiovascular mortality. And over a period of time, the more you take, it is reduced. So 5 servings of fruits, I say even 3 servings, can reduce heart attack by 25 to 30%. As simple as that. Any vegetables and fruits you can take, which are seasonal, need not be costly, and this will reduce heart disease so much. Then whole grains also, the similar studies there, more than 3 lakhs. These people who have been followed for as long as 14 to 15 years, and you can see that if you take whole grains, which are not refined, the heart disease is reduced by about 20% or so. So there is evidence that all these things which are recommended have evidence. Similar, these are nuts. This is a Seventh-day Adventist study. These are vegetarian. It was shown vegetarian people have less heart disease, but those vegetarians who were using nuts 5 times a week, nuts means almonds, cashew nuts and walnuts, etc. They had 25% less disease, heart disease. And nuts are extremely good for prevention of heart disease and diabetes. They even decrease the obesity. Although they are rich in fat, you know, all these nuts have 40% fat. And this fat can increase the weight, but because there are a lot of fiber in these, and therefore the appetite is reduced. And a lot of benefits of nuts have been shown. If we use nuts, I think this extremely, we can reduce this heart disease significantly. It can be cheap nuts also, as I said. It can be monkey nuts or moongfali that we call. Now, there is evidence, as I said, for Mediterranean diet, and this is true for vegetarian diet, for primary prevention. This is a huge study in which more than 22,000 adults were followed, and they were given Mediterranean versus the usual, and you can see there is a 25% reduction in the incidence of coronary artery. This is a primary prevention. These are people who were not having heart disease. These people were given high amount of legumes, fruits, nuts, cereal, and so on. This is called vegetarian. So Mediterranean diet has been clearly shown. Not only that, Mediterranean diet, and this is true of Indian vegetarian diet also with mustard oil, because it's more or less similar, omega-3, etc. This is a study, very famous study, an old study. This is a French study which shows that if after heart attack you give Mediterranean diet, this reduces the chances of getting heart attack by more than 60% in 4 years. This is much better than statins. This is a study done before statins were involved. So this is a diet which is much better than all the drugs that we know of, whether it's statins or other drugs that we give after heart attack. So a good diet after a heart attack can reduce second incidence by as much as 60%. So finally, I think there's a huge topic in itself I'm not going to, but what you eat is important. What is eating is equally important. And this is what our ancient literature told us. If you are stressed, a lot of data is there that it should be mindfulness eating. you know, the doctors do in a hurry. They eat it, especially lunch. They are one hand lunch is there, other hand they are working. So you should sit down, eat your food with peaceful. If you are stressed, the same food can become bad. It has also been shown now that eating slowly, we were told 32 teeth are there, we should chew it. There are a lot of data now that if you eat fast, you can get diabetes, insulin resistance can increase. And low heat cooking is much better than fast cooking. It's also coming out. There's some few studies. So you should do this usual heating that microwaves may not be very good. So important thing is what you eat is important, but if you are under stress, the same food can become bad. You should really remain relaxed. You should also eat slowly, and you should have mindfulness, so-called eating. If you are concentrating on eating and thinking the benefit of it, this is very important. As it has been said that many people live to eat, but I think what you eat to live only. We should eat that much, that is enough for us to survive. Now, smoking, I don't want to go tobacco, is the most important preventable cause. And you know the heart attacks and so on and so forth. They can affect almost every organ, including the lungs, the ulcers, the cardiovascular disease, aging, asthma, reduced lifespan, even rheumatoid arthritis and so on. So I think this is the biggest curse that a human is facing. And this is data from so-called inter-heart study in which heart attack causes were found. They found that the more you smoke, the more are the chances of it. But even one cigarette is bad. You see, this is now said that one or two cigarettes may not be bad. It has been clearly shown even one cigarette is bad, it can increase the risk by 5 to 10%. So, and the more, of course, you smoke, the chances are increasing almost 10 to 20%. So one should not smoke at all. One should not use any other form of BDs, possibly more harmful, and other tobacco chewing, which is quite common in India, is much more harmful because it causes cancer of the throat. And the risk reduces if you stop smoking. These are several studies which say people stop smoking after a heart attack, and you can see that the disease decreases by as much as 30 to 40%. So decreasing smoking can immediately affect it, and over a period of time, it can become. Then lack of exercise, very important for the urban population. You see, 1/3 of the deaths in heart disease are in men, and 38% are because of lack of physical exercise. Lack of physical exercise is one of the biggest killer. And this is what is happening, as you see here, people watching the TV, especially in this too, during Corona period. And the reason is because physical inactivity has a lot of physiological effects. Physical inactivity can cause dyslipidemia, inflammation, and it can cause atherosclerosis. If a patient is elderly, has diabetes, obesity, genetic, then it increases earlier, hypertension, smoking, then also increase. So physical inactivity has tremendous effects in causing atherosclerosis. Not only that, but also obesity and diabetes and so on. Physical inactivity doubles the risk of heart attacks. Simple as that, 100%. And type 2 diabetes mellitus and obesity and hypertension. Increase the risk of hypertension by 30%, doubles the risk of dying from cardiovascular disease and stroke. So if you are getting this disease and you are not active, you will get this. And more than 3 million deaths are attributed to physical inactivity. This was in 2008. I'm sure the number has increased. This is long back, but a huge number of people die because of that. But globally, 31% of adults age 15 and over are insufficiently active. So it is 1/3, but I'm sure it's much more now, according to some of the work which has been done from India. More than 40% of the people in the urban population are not physically active. And the economic cost of physical inactivity has been estimated to be $53.8 billion. So I think this is very important to tell people that this is a very cheap method, and one should use the pedestrian if one walks to the work rather than on car, and one uses cycle. This is encouraged in the Western countries. I think we should also tell the authorities to try to have these walking tracks and cycle tracks. This will decrease the cost to the exchequer also, which is huge. You can see 53 billion. And the benefits of exercise, you all know, controls weight, reduces stress, anxiety, depression, increases HDL, good cholesterol, lowers triglycerides, and the clotting mechanism is reduced. And pool data from studies show that deaths can come down by 25%, even in patients who have heart attack with exercise. So exercise is extremely useful. And it's a part of cardiac rehabilitation. This is one thing which is not really used. And I will show you, yoga is a very good method of cardiac rehabilitation. The cardiac rehabilitation, which is usually by exercise, reduces the mortality by as much as 25%. And cardiac mortality is still higher, up to 36%. And of course, the quality of life improves. And admissions are also reduced by 50%. And it improves quality of life, functional capacity. But it is not done in our country. And I will show you what is the best method to do it, because this is a little more complicated. You need gadgets and early return to work. This is very important, because a patient who gets disease, he has to get well. Then another factor is lack of sleep. And this is also related to stress. And now it has been shown that if you sleep less than about 6 to 8 hours, then you can have a lot of problems. It's a very important risk factor. So there are difficulties in memory and learning, increases irritability, accident, illness, lack of energy, stress, weight gain, rapid aging. We all know that obstructive sleep apnea, which is an extreme form of sleep, is associated with diabetes, heart disease, and hypertension. So now it has been shown that lack of sleep can cause heart disease. There's a large number of studies. So sleeping for about 6 to 7 hours a day is important. And most of the people are not able to sleep because of stress. So this is the most important factor, as I was saying, the stress. These are psychosocial risk factors for coronary heart disease. They have been really not given much emphasis. I'll talk about them a little bit. Here, psychosocial stress can be acute. Acute, for example, there's an earthquake or a terrorist attack or the loss of it's acute. And then there's the chronic, which is much more important. There are emotional factors which can cause, which are caused by stress, like depression, anxiety, anger, also. They are all increasing, you know, that anxiety, depression. There was, it was said that India has possibly the highest patients with depression, especially ladies. And this is a great concern. I assure you, depression is a very important risk factor. It can cause heart diseases. Then there are social factors, socioeconomic status, social support, isolation, etc. So these are some of the factors which are important. And now it has been shown that this stress, how does it cause the disease? It has been shown that the stress, which is produced really in the mind, it affects the brain in many ways. It stimulates the hypothalamic pituitary amygdala, so the HPA axis. And the result is that once you stimulate this HPA axis, you release large number of hormones like glucagon, cortisol, adrenaline, vasopressins, which can further cause even dyslipidemia. They can also affect the pancreas, causing decrease in insulin and so on. And they can be inflammatory. They can change the behavior of the individual. And that's very important. You see, I think behavior, I'll talk about it in a minute. And the other side, they also stimulate the sympathetic nervous system, which releases epinephrine and norepinephrine, and which affects the heart rate, blood viscosity, and they interact so that these serious diseases are caused by stress. Coronary heart disease, diabetes mellitus, metabolic syndrome, arrhythmias, heart failure, and sudden death. You must have heard about that sudden anxiety, the sudden abnormal news can cause sudden death. It can cause heart failure. Now we know there is a stress-induced cardiomyopathy, which is simulates this is due to acute stress and so on and so. And of course, it can cause arrhythmias. And it was not known about hypertension. I have not been clearly shown that this is caused by that. And as I will show you, yoga can take care of all these factors. And these are these risk factors. If you see this was in Framingham long back, you know that factors which cause heart disease are hypertension, smoking, diabetes, cholesterol. But if you see in the lowermost, if there's a clinical depression, then this is the highest risk actually. It doubles the risk of heart disease. So risk, it's a very important risk factor for causation. And if a person has heart disease, for example, these are patients with after a heart attack, if they have severe depression, then the mortality is increased by 30%. So depression after a heart attack is extremely harmful. It can increase the mortality in spite of one who has done a good job. Similarly, after angioplasty, it is called. Similarly, after heart failure, because depression itself is an inflammatory state and it can release catecholamine. We could many mechanisms, but depression or anxiety after this extremely harmful. And this is a study after angioplasty. This is after the stents that we use. If a person has a personality D, it's called distressed personality. It's not depression, it is distressed personality. Person, it's called type D personality, which is more important than type A personality. Because now this person's don't want to report to the doctor, they don't believe they have anything else. But a lot of overlap of depression. So personality D is there after angioplasty. You can see that after 6 months, the chances of complications are increased 4 times. So even if you have done the extremely good procedure and patients are under stress, this can. Yoga can counteract all this. Now, I'll deal about my research also and some of the other published thing in yoga. Because yoga, once I started, it was not understood by the patient. They said, doctor, we don't want to do yoga. It's very complicated posture. But I must tell you, it's not only a few postures, but a complete way of, it's a holistic way of life. It aims at the harmonious development of body, mind, leading to physical well-being, mental harmony, culminating to positive thinking, happiness and peace. A lot of data is there that it can cause positive thinking, happiness and peace. Actually, it's a lifestyle, which I'll tell you, consists of physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual well-being. And a lot of studies are there that can reduce work stress, anxiety, depression, and improve sleep. As I said, these are the 4 components of yoga lifestyle. Physical, mental, emotional, spiritual. Physical means diet is a part of yoga. Sattvic diet, the type of diet I talk. Physical exercise is a part of yoga. Actually, if you do certain exercises repeatedly, like Surya Namaskar, it is like a mild to moderate exercise. And of course, yoga also tells you not to use tobacco or alcohol. I think yoga is extremely good for de-addiction. We have used it in our patients who were smokers, and once they started on a yogi lifestyle, tobacco cessation is very important. Similarly, drugs and alcohol, all these things can be. Then mental is a very important part of mental well-being, that is stress management. As I said, stress is a very important component. So this is achieved by meditation. A huge number of articles are there on meditation improving the stress. And emotional well-being, I think ignore that anger, ego, jealousy, hostility, all these things have been shown to increase the diseases. We don't know the role exactly, but the anger we know has been shown to cause heart disease and so on. Ego, jealousy, all these things have been shown. And the positive emotions like compassion and love. And this can be achieved only by yoga. Because yoga, you know, acts at a higher level. It doesn't work the body, it affects at the mind. It takes the lower mind to the higher mind or the intellect. So I think emotional well-being is very, very important. We all know that. Even it's been shown in experimental animals that anger can cause atherosclerosis, even when you take low-fat diet. So I think more studies have to be done on emotion and the various diseases. They have a significant huge role. And now the mechanism is understood. And of course, again, spiritual faith and moral faith. A lot of studies are there. The people who are spiritual, they have less heart disease, and they have less cancer. And if they get the disease, they recover fast. Even prayer has been shown to improve the condition of the patient. Even if other people pray for you, you may improve much earlier. A lot of studies there in prayers and several serious diseases. You can look at the internet or Google and see how many studies are there. So yoga is therefore a holistic and intensive lifestyle body game consisting of stress management, healthy diet, regular exercise, and avoidance of tobacco. This, I call it a lifestyle polypill. I named it several years back because this is the polypill which reduces all the risk factors which cause cancer. Actually, this is the best method of remaining healthy also, because health is, as you know, WHO has defined, it's not only absence of disease, but a state of physical, mental, emotional, and social well-being and spiritual well-being. So I think yoga achieves all this. It can make you really healthy. Not only prevents you from the disease, but also makes you mentally and physically and spiritually healthy. So this is a lifestyle polypill. And it has been used in many conditions. I will not have the time to talk about that. It has been used in so many conditions for treating, for example, if there are headaches, there to reduce the mental stress and so on, even irritable bowel syndrome, even it has been used in bronchial asthma and so on. But the maximum use has been in patients with heart disease. And we'll talk about the role of yoga in heart disease. Because heart disease, as you know, can be considered as a vicious cycle. It's a, for example, you know, heart disease starts because of certain risk factors like high cholesterol, hypertension, diabetes, smoking. If patients have these risk factors, they are likely to get this disease. Now, what do these risk factors do? They cause oxidative stress in blood vessels, and they also cause inflammation. So inflammation and the damage to the arteries is there because of this risk factor. And yoga, as I show you, can affect both inflammation as well as all these risk factors. Then these in some complicated way, this stress and inflammation causes atherosclerosis, which is initially early. It takes several years for atherosclerosis to produce symptoms. So mild atherosclerosis, up to 70% blockage, is called mild, and this develops, and this can be reversed even at least completely. But when it advances more than 70%, it can cause ischemia or angina. Yoga can be helpful there. I'll show you there are studies that there. And ultimately, it can cause heart attacks, and which can cause arrhythmias and heart failure. And yoga can act there also. So yoga can act at any stage of this so-called cycle of heart disease. I'll show you the evidence. Now, there's a strong evidence that yoga is extremely useful for cardiovascular stress and recovery from cardiovascular stress, and cardiovascular system is there. And there are a large number of randomized studies, meta-analysis, and review articles that yoga has been shown to be extremely beneficial in anxiety, depression, and psychosocial stress. So it has been extensively used as an effective technique for stress management. A number of trials are there. One of the trials show that they are as effective as drugs in depression without any side effect. Now, what is the mechanism that has been studied? That there is alteration in the neurotransmitters like serotonin, GABA, etc. So I think this is how the antidepressants also act. They act on serotonin, and yoga does the same. So there are a large number of studies that you see, more than hundreds, to show that it's extremely useful. And therefore, if it is useful, it will be useful for prevention of heart disease, and even after heart disease, it should be useful to prevent it. Now, the commonest problem that we have is hypertension. Now, yoga has been shown, there are a large number of studies available now in more than 10,000 individuals. These are randomized controlled studies, which you can see here in this chart. And it has been shown that in majority of the studies, there is a modest decrease in blood pressure. The decrease is modest, but the systolic can be 5 to 10, and diastolic can be 3 to 5. And, but this is enough in the population level to decrease heart attacks. And so I think you can see these are a randomized trial which have been shown in this table in as many as 10,000 patients. Different types of yoga has been used. And the duration also has been 1 week to 4 years. Most of the studies are less than a year or so. That is the only. And because this data was so strong, even in 2013, this is the scientific statement from American Heart Association said that meditation, which is a part of yoga, it has modest effect on lowering blood pressure. And of course, the class was 2B, a level of evidence was B. It was consensus that it is reasonable for every individual with blood pressure mildly elevated, more than 120/80, it should be used. And this is the latest guideline, you see, which has been the 2020 International Society of Hypertension. These are practical guidelines. And for the first time, they have said that one should use yoga and meditation in the non-pharmacological treatment of hypertension. So I think the importance is being understood because the studies are so many. Yoga has been considered here equal to mild physical exercise, and meditation here has been considered to counter the stress, which is an important factor. So I think yoga and meditation have come in the modern medicine already. And this is a huge article which was reported again in American Heart Journal that meditation and cardiovascular risk reduction. So although they have said this is too busy a slide, but the gist is that although these studies have some deficiencies and more studies are needed, but yoga being a simple, cost-effective technique could be used in control of risk factors and in control of mild hypertension. We have also used a study using ambulatory blood pressure. We found a small decrease in blood pressure. And a small decrease in the population level, if you decrease even 3 millimeter systolic in the general population, you can decrease the stroke by 10% and heart disease by 6%. So a small decrease can have a big effect on this thinking. There are many patients we have treated now with resistant hypertension. A lot of stress and the blood pressure is controlled. Now, diabetes is another problem. And we have the diabetic capital and all. Does yoga have an effect? Again, you can see there are a large number of studies. There are small studies. Follow-up is also small, usually less than 1 year in most of the studies. And different type of yoga has been used. Like the Sudarshan, we have the meditation, or the conventional yoga, which consists of all the asanas, breathing, and the meditation. And all of them, majority of them have shown, 22 out of 24 have shown, there is a modest decrease in the HbA1c, 0.5 to 1, which is equal to any drug that we use, like metformin, without any side effects also. But not only the Hb blood sugars are improved, but the patients, also the stress decreases, the central obesity decreases, the cholesterol also improves. So there are a large number of other benefits which are there. And this is the largest study ever done in diabetes. I think this will come in the guidelines. This is an Indian study done from Bangalore, Dr. Nagendra's lab. And this is a huge study of about 3,400 pre-diabetic patients. You see, like we did a study in pre-hypertension. So pre-hypertension, pre-diabetes, these patients are liable to develop hypertension. So they took 3,400 patients pre-diabetics. And the HbA1c was 5.7 to 6.49 from 29 states and randomized them. And yoga was given for 3 months. And at 3 months, dramatic results were there, that there was a 47% reduction in the new onset diabetes. If you use yoga in these patients pre-diabetes, which are very common in India, 50% reduction in diabetes. So it's very good prevention. And the normoglycemia, the diabetes was completely disappeared in 52% of yoga as compared to 39. So this is one method of completely curing the diabetes in the early stages. So short-term yoga practice can prevent diabetes. This was presented in American Diabetic Association in 2019 and got one of the best prizes, gold medal, because of the best paper ever presented. So I think yoga is coming into diabetes practice also, especially for prevention, just like in hypertension. And this is extremely useful because yoga has no side effects. And then this is a very common disease, what is called as the metabolic syndrome. That Indians may not be overweight, they weight maybe more, but they are obese in the abdomen. It's called central obesity. And this is very common in Indians. More than 50% of Indians have this. And this predisposes to diabetes and heart disease. This is our study which we did some years back in Bangaram Hospital. We took 100 people with metabolic syndrome. They were absolutely healthy otherwise. And the only thing is that they have wasting and they had slightly high blood pressure, slightly high cholesterol. So half of them, 50, we gave them yoga for a year, other half usual conventional lifestyle. And what we found is that on the right side, you see in the yoga group, there was a decrease in the carotid intimal medial thickness. Carotid intimal medial thickness means the arteries which are hardened because of atherosclerosis, they had decreased now. This early atherosclerosis was significantly reduced. So in these patients who did not have coronary artery disease or did not have any blockages, but the thickening of the carotid intimal thickness, and it was reduced, indicating that the disease can be reversed. So this is the first study of its kind we reported it some years back. In addition to that, the other parameters also of metabolic syndrome, like the body mass index, the waist circumference, the HDL, LDL, and systolic blood pressure, all significantly changed. And this indicates that yoga can have a tremendous effect in these patients who are having pre-diabetes syndrome. So it's extremely useful for metabolic syndrome. What about advanced coronary arteries? We get patients who have 70-80% blockage. And there are three studies which have been done, randomized studies using coronary angiography. Dean Ornish did it in 90, reported 90 at 5 years follow. But he took patients who were having blockages, only mild blockages. The average blockage was 40%. So 40% to many cardiologists said is does not help, because these are patients asymptomatic. And if 40 becomes 37, it's not clinical importance. So we took a study, we did a study in which more than 70% blockages were there. This was done in India, it was reported. And as Dr. Bansal said, it has been reported many times, the progression of coronary atherosclerosis. This is for the first time when we used a diet which was very practical, unlike the Dean Ornish, who had used diet in the hotels and all the time. And we did show significant improvement. And there's a third trial by Ram Kumaris, Dr. Gupta, who has done Raj Yoga. So these are in about 400 patients. Our two trials, lifestyle and yoga lifestyle, was only about 50 patients, but they have done up to 300. And therefore, I think results are exactly the same. So whatever method of yoga meditation you do, there are so many methods, the results are the same. What are the results? In all these studies, we found that body mass index, the weight reduced in these patients, the cholesterol reduced. This is before statins were regularly used. Statins were not using this. So cholesterol was significantly reduced, especially the triglycerides, and HDL increased, slight decrease in the LDL. Angina decreased markedly. This was very important. The patients were symptomatic and angina, and also stress test was done in most of these patients. That also improved markedly. There was a treadmill test of thallium. On angiography, you could see regression. It was for small, maybe 10% or so, 5 to 10%, but it was there. Progression was not there, as against in the control. The psychosocial stress improved. That was very important, because these people, already people have stress, and if they think their arteries are blocked, stress is markedly improved. So that was markedly improved just because of yoga practice. And this is the compliance was more than 80%. Now you see, it is said that people do not follow what is told to them. Even medicines, they don't follow. They don't follow the diet, exercise. But we found in this study, all these studies showed that compliance was very good, showing that the willpower of these individuals markedly improved. They start thinking positive. Now, this is a 1 year study, but what about longer than that? There's only one study from the United States. This is a transcendental meditation, which has been shown, followed up to 9 years. These are patients of heart disease, already having heart disease. And we were given meditation, part of yoga, and followed for 9 years. And we found that there is a 48% reduction in the new events like deaths, non-fatal microinfarction, non-fatal stroke. So if you continue yogic practice, it appears that you can reduce the reoccurrence of the disease by as much as 50%. So extremely useful, but more studies are needed. It is only one study. And what about atrial fibrillation, arrhythmias? For example, this is atrial fibrillation is a very common arrhythmia which is found in the elderly. Its incidence is increasing in Indians also. And this is the main reason for stroke. And it was shown in one of these American studies that atrial fibrillation episodes are significantly reduced because of yoga and the silent episodes and the non-silent. So this is extremely useful in atrial. In ventricular ectopics, it has been shown. Even there are studies from AICD, automatic implantable defibrillator, there also the shocks are reduced because the stress is controlled.
What about cardiac rehabilitation?
As I said, it is really not practiced in our country, although it can reduce mortality by 25%. Now, there are two studies available. One is after a bypass surgery in 250 patients. This is from again Dr. Nagin. And they have shown that if you use yoga only as cardiac rehabilitation, there's a significant improvement in ejection fraction in the blood glucose and lipids, and also the quality of life improves, depression, etc. decreases. So there was an excellent compliance with yoga practice. This is a small study, one center study. But this is the, I think, largest study ever done, yoga-based cardiac rehabilitation after acute myocardial infarction. This is a study which has been done in a large number of centers in India, 24 medical centers, including about 4,000 patients. We were also a part of it. My colleague, Dr. Durai Rai, was the chief investigator. And this has been published in one of the most prestigious journals, called the Journal of American College of Cardiology, with extremely good editorial comments. I think everybody should read this because this is a landmark article. And this shows that if you use yoga as cardiac rehabilitation, the patient's quality of life markedly improves, the quality of life improves, and also the recurrent events, as you can, the curves are diverting. Although it did not reach statistical significance, as you can see that the reason could be many, that we had less events and the follow-up was short. Now longer follow-up is being followed. So you can see that the death, the myocardial infarction and stroke occurrence significantly reduced. And this is a landmark analysis which can be done. These are patients who followed yoga regularly, and you can see that the statistically significant difference at 22 months already. So if you follow yoga after heart attack, the effects are similar to cardiac rhythm, and very simple, cost effective. So this editorial was written that this is one of the best methods of cardiac rehabilitation in the developing countries, middle income and low income countries, but not only that, it's for the higher countries also, higher income group countries, because cardiac rehabilitation is hardly done there also. More than 40% of patients don't get this. So this could be a very good method of using it, because this is the largest multi-centric study. It's like diabetic study, you said. This is the largest study ever done in completion, one of the best studies. I'm sure that this is going to have a big impact on the cardiology practice in our country. But this will come into the mainstream very soon. Of course, long-term studies are being done. We are doing studies in heart failure also, and other also such. Now, what is the mechanism of yoga? How does it improve all this? I did not show in heart failure and other conditions also, it's informed. So we have just finished a study that in heart failure it improves ejection fraction, also quality of life, and also improves the biomarkers like NT-proBNP. So how does yoga act? The exact cause is not known, but it seems there are four pathways it may be acting upon. But the first pathway is that with yoga, we have shown that the MRI, functional MRI, changes in the brain occur, which reduces stress. It also decreases sympathetic system. And there's a deactivation of the hypophysis pituitary axis. As I said, there's activation in stress and there's a deactivation. So all those hormones are significantly reduced. And there's a new term, there's a change in the brain structure and function with yoga. Earlier we used to say that the brain cannot grow after a few years, but even in elderly people, it has been shown, this is a term called neuroplasticity, which is new, that the thickness of the brain can increase, the gray matter can increase, and the interconnections also improve. So brain can grow with yoga, and large number of, this is called neuroplasticity of the brain, which was never known. Yoga has shown by MRI findings. So neuroplasticity, the brain connections improve, the brain activity, and that also helps in reducing the stress, etc. And because of deactivation of the hypophysic pituitary axis, there is a increase in the glucose tolerance, and increase in the insulin sensitivity, enhanced psychosocial profile, and there is an improved oxidative stress endothelial function. On the other side, yoga also improves the vagal stimulation. As you know, pranayama, several activities are there. So vagal stimulation, as parasympathetic activities increase, which increases the heart rate variability, baroreceptor variable sensitivity, which can improve blood pressure, and also decreases inflammatory cytokines. So these things interact, and then they can decrease atherosclerosis, hypertension, arrhythmias, and diabetes. Yoga is also a part of mild exercise. As I said, if you do power yoga or repeated pranayama, it's like doing moderate exercise, mild to moderate exercise. Exercise itself had advantages, and that adds. So this is how it has been considered that atherosclerosis, hypertension, and diabetes could be controlled by yoga. Now, many Western books say that it is very difficult to modify the lifestyle. They say that it's very easy to get a bypass, but difficult. So many studies in the literature suggest that it is difficult to change. And that's not my experience. That's what I don't think so. The reason is, I think the approach which is followed so far is that we are not able to control the mind. You know? It is the weakness of the mind. I ask my patients, why don't you exercise? They say, I get up in the morning, I want to exercise, but my mind says, don't go till tomorrow. Never comes. He goes to a party, and there the mind says, eat this, it's bad for you, but tomorrow you won't eat. So I think the mind is weak. And this is what we have shown in yoga, that if you start yoga, the mind control is there. And then the compliance with the diet and exercise improves markedly to as much as 80 to 90%. So I think the approach should be, if you want to change the behavior of the individual, which I have shown yoga can do that, or improve the mind control, then you have to use yoga first. So if you combine yoga with this lifestyle, we have seen, at least I have seen, and others have also reported, that the compliance improves by 80 to 90%, not only in diet exercise, also doing yoga, and also drugs if they are taken. So I think the approach, if you want to modify the lifestyle, you have to firstly make their mind strong. So to conclude, lifestyle modification is extremely beneficial for primary and secondary prevention of coronary artery. I've shown a lot of evidences, however, not given adequate importance. Doctors don't have time for this. I would suggest that doctors should spend a lot of time on this, because this is a better method than even drugs. We only talk of medicine up and down, but we don't talk. Every time a patient comes, you must ask, I do that at least. Are you following the diet? Are you following exercise? Are you following yoga? Are you stressed, and so on and so forth. So I think if these things are asked by doctors again and again, the compliance would be better. We should give due importance to this. Lifestyle modification is simple and fixed. It's very, very important, because the treatment cost of heart disease has increased markedly. And therefore, these are simple, cost-effective techniques. And yoga is a holistic lifestyle that is especially useful for prevention and regression of atherosclerosis and rehabilitation. And lifestyle modification could be used alone, especially for primary prevention, or in combination with drugs to prevent coronary artery disease. If a patient has a heart attack, then you have to combine it with the drugs. Drugs are important, like statins and aspirin, etc. But I think for primary prevention, you can use it alone. And I have used it not only for primary prevention, but also for the management of many conditions, like mild hypertension, mild diabetes, mild obesity, mild dyslipidemia. In all these conditions, it's extremely useful, and especially if the patient has mental stress. And this is the simple formula I want to give, holistic. Dean Ornish said this thing: if you want to really remain well, from illness to wellness, replace your I with V. That ego should be replaced, and this is what yoga can do, and change it to V. This means to be care and share. So if you lose your eye, that is ego, and try to take care of others also, share, then disease will not occur. And finally, to the modern doctors, I say, who I think are inferior doctors, a very old Chinese proverb. It was in 1600 BC, it was written, superior doctors prevent the disease. That means before the disease occurs, they are called best doctors. Then mediocre doctors treat the disease before evident. That is in the early stage of the disease, subclinical disease. inferior doctors treat the full blown disease. I think we are at present inferior doctors who are treating full blown disease. Let's be superior doctors. And we all know prevention is better than cure. I think we know theoretically, but I think there's a lot of evidence that if you try to prevent the disease by cost effective techniques like yoga, which is like lifestyle quality, you can have a big impact on the prevention of these diseases, which are killing a large number of people, like heart disease and like diabetes, hypertension, and others. So thank you very much. And I think all doctors should really know how to do this yoga. And our prime minister has made yoga very popular because it's been accepted all over the world. For the last 5 years, International Day of Yoga has been celebrated. I at least tell the doctors that first do it yourself, and then you can tell the patient, because the benefits that you get sometimes are not explainable in the studies that we see. And all those doctors who have done it, it's not difficult to do. My patients who were 70, 80 years could do it sitting on the chair. You don't have to sit even on the floor. And there are simple exercises one has to do. One is stretching exercise. Stretching itself has been shown to be beneficial. There are several types, starting from the neck to the joints and all. So keep the joints mobile and stretching. The second is breathing exercises, which are very simple. Normally, you know, we breathe through our chest. In yoga, we say we should do diaphragmatic breathing or abdominal breathing. When we take in breath, the abdomen should come out. And this practice, we, and more than 20% of vital capacity can increase if you are using abdominal breathing. So we are not using our lungs adequately. We can use it adequately and then slow it down. Now it has been shown that when we are stressed, the breathing is fast, and if we are relaxed, so if you do it slowly, in a minute, you reduce from 18 to 20 to 12 or 10, then the mind gets relaxed. There's a large number of studies are there, but breathing helps, and there's a strong lung and the brain connection. And finally, is the meditation, and that can easily be done. Again, you have to concentrate on something, maybe your breath, and just concentrate on that. Let the thoughts come, but don't ignore them. Like you see a movie, you see, it does not have an impact. A scene comes, another scene comes, you are not affected. Similarly, when you are doing meditation, let the thoughts come, but do not react to them. And slowly, what happens is a good or bad thought does not affect you. This is what the whole idea of yoga is, and I call it a yogic attitude. People ask me how long you should do. You start with, you have to start 1 hour, but later on, it becomes an attitude. If you are sitting straight, if you are breathing slowly, if you are thinking properly, that means if somebody tells bad or good things, you are not affected, that is yoga. So yogic attitude is there. During eating, you have to do yoga, that is concentration, without watching the TV or anything like that. As I said, it is the way you eat also affects your digestion and so on and so forth. And even while walking, you can do yoga. Concentration with positive thinking is meditation. So I would suggest that the doctors should do it themselves, because doctors themselves have a lot of stress these days. I've been a teacher for the last 50 years, and I see that doctors have tremendous stress. They don't have a healthy lifestyle. And the result is doctors' life is less, 10 years less than the general population. Studies from India as well as United States too. So I think let's become, not the sort of slogan shouters. Let's practice before we tell our patients. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Enlightening session.
Any questions? I'll be very happy.
Two, three questions are there, sir.
Yes.
But before that, I would like to know why there is difference between, although we know that stress is not good for health, still we are continuing our life with stress. So why there's gap between what we know and what we live?
This is because mind control is not there. See, as I said, I gave you an example. I ask my patients, why don't you exercise? They know exercise is good. They want to do it. Now, these doctors are the same. So they tell me, doctor, I get up in the morning, but my mind says you had a late night. Some excuse it's finding. Don't do it today. Do it tomorrow. But tomorrow never comes. I go to a party. I know this food is bad, but my mind says, have it today, not tomorrow. The tomorrow never comes. It's lack of control. And secondly, I think there's a sense of negation. I'm treating heart patients. How can I have heart disease? That's not true. I have found that I did a study long back that heart disease is very common in the top cardiologists and cardiac surgeons all over the country. You can see, take examples of that. So I think we should not have negation. And thirdly, as I said, in the olden days, this was there in yoga and Ayurveda, that a teacher had to perfect himself or herself in that field before he could advise. That is a thing I think we should inculcate into that. And the fourth reason is, you see, these doctors are not very happy. You see, the question is, happiness cannot come unless you are doing yoga, unless you are controlling your lifestyle, unless you're controlling stress. A lot of data is there. Harvard Medical School did a study why happiness comes. It's not the money which causes happiness. It is your attitude. It is your, if you are satisfied with whatever you have, if you are helping others, if you have that gratitude. So there are so many factors which are all part of yoga. So if you want to be happy, I think you should do that. I think doctors are living in a world of negation, that I treat patients, I'll not get it. But I think they are the ones who are living 10 years shorter. This is data there in US as well as in India. So I think we should not live in a negation. And secondly, I think we've never been told what yoga is. If you ask me, I've been a teacher for 50 years. They don't know yoga, they think it's complicated asanas and all. They don't think it's a lifestyle. The exercise they know is lifestyle. But they don't know stress management is also a lifestyle. So yoga is nothing but a lifestyle. It's just a lifestyle which includes all those things. Diet includes exercise, includes stress management, which they don't really think of. So I think the doctors are living in what I call fool's paradise. The disease can occur to everybody who does not follow the healthy lifestyle.
There's one question, sir, regarding triglyceride.
Yes. You see, there are several lipids which are bad or good for the heart. One is total cholesterol. Total is not that much good. But it is the LDL which is the biggest culprit. It's the bad cholesterol. The lower, the better. For example, it should be less than 100 in primary prevention. And if you have a disease, it should be very low, as much as 40 they have now gone to, or even 30 with statins, etc. So LDL is a bad cholesterol. It should be as low as possible. The second is triglycerides. Again, a bad thing. It should be, again, lower than 200, less than 150. Triglycerides were not considered as harmful earlier, but now a lot of data is there that residual risk, in spite of the fact you control LDL, the risk remains high in many patients, and the reason is triglycerides. There's a study done which shows that if you give omega-3 high dose special type, you can reduce mortality by reducing triglycerides. But triglycerides can be affected by diet and exercise. Most of the patients, if they do exercise every day, half an hour every day, and cut down your refined food, no sugar, as I said, no white bread, no white rice, and don't eat outside. Outside the home, then the triglycerides will come down. So triglycerides can come down markedly. Triglycerides are also increased in diabetes and in hypothyroidism. Correct those things, triglycerides come down. But if they remain high, then there are medicines available now which we can try to reduce it. So triglycerides are also important. The third is the HDL. It's considered as the good cholesterol. The higher, the better, they say. But there's no medicine which has been proven which the HDL. The only way to increase HDL is exercise and maybe diet and, for example, some nuts, etc. And so on. And maybe mustard oil, omega-3. But now it has been shown that very high HDL is also bad. So HDL has remained as a complicated. So not too high HDL, and it should be moderate, but we cannot control it because HDL can be only by exercise, no medicine. Triglyceride, yes. LDL, yes. So I think these are the various things you should usual practice of lipid.
Sir, how to control LDL, which is resistant?
Well, LDL, as I said, can be affected by a few things. For example, exercise can bring down LDL. There are two types of LDL. One is small, dense LDL. Small, dense is the one which increases in Indians. This is metabolic. The total cholesterol may be normal, but still we get disease because it has been shown small, dense. So exercise can bring down the small dents and total cholesterol to a small extent. Exercise reduces triglycerides, increases HDL. So that is one, by exercise. The diet has little effect on the LDL. You can reduce it by taking a low-fat diet. If you're taking too much of trans fats, if you reduce it, it will come down. If you're taking too much of saturated fats, it may come down slightly. Cholesterol does not have much effect. Although we can take up to 300 milligrams, not too much of cholesterol. So diet can have very mild effect on LDL. So LDL is really a problem, and therefore LDL can be reduced by statins. Any patient who has got a heart attack, we always give statins in high dosages. So bring it down to less than 70. The patient is high risk, even less than 40 or 30. There are studies available to show that LDL should be as low as possible. And I always like to bring it to 40 or 30. Because when we are born, our LDL is very, very low, 30 or so. And if we get 30, we'll never get this heart disease. I always say, if we remain like a child, we'll never get the heart disease. Now, child has a LDL, as I said, of 30. If we have LDL, never get heart disease. Secondly, the child smiles 200 times a day. We don't smile once in 2 or 3 days. Laughter is the best medicine, and a lot of data is there. I'm not going to do it, but if we start smiling, that's a part of yoga also. Laughter yoga is a part of it. If we smile, and thirdly, the posture of the child, you know, it's called as the Shavasana. He lies in a posture which is like that. Most of the asanas are taken from the small children and all. So the comfortable posture, it's called Shavasana, the way the child lies down. And so we, like children, will never get the disease at all. And the reason we, the child breathes, you know, abdominal breathing, like yogic breathing. By the time child, when he's born till the age of 5 years, once he starts going to school, he produce stress. There's competition, we should be topping this and that. And the teachers also, with them, peer pressures, their breathing changes. A study done that even if you can change the breathing in children, small, they become more peaceful and their efficiency improves. So this is the way one should do that. But there are medicines for LDL, you see. LDL, you have statins, which are extremely poor. You can have another drug called ezetimibe. You have also these intravenous drugs, which can be reducing it markedly. Thank you.
Sir, your comment on sugar-free versus sugar.
Sugar is a poison, as I said. Sugar is very cholesterol. Sugar should not be eaten at all. That's what I would say. But occasionally, small amount is not bad. But I mean, as you try to discourage, you can take jaggery. You can take what is called as shakar, which is not refined. See? As I said, refining takes up all the good things. There's a fiber in this. There are antioxidants in good, etc. And then the absorption is slow. You see, when why does diabetes occur or other things? As you take the sugar, easily absorbed, so the blood sugar goes up very quickly. Insulin is liberated to produce it and all. So it can cause diabetes. This insulin imbalance can also cause atherosclerosis. So this is the new cholesterol. So I would say that one can take sugar-free, but if you want to take any brown, it's called brown sugar, it's called good here, it's called jaggery. In the US also, they're taking this brown sugar. It is unrefined, because refined things are bad, especially cold drinks are terribly bad. A lot of data now that these cold drinks which the children take, which are full of sugar, they can be as many as 12 to 16 spoons of sugar in one bottle of cold drink, that means cola drinks that we take. So they're very, very high. So one should avoid it as much as possible. Now, sugar has been shown clearly to be related to that. So sugar, if a person takes sugar-free, I don't mind that. But even if a person likes the sweets, you can take jaggery or unrefined sugar. Just like, as I said, instead of white bread, you can take brown bread. So what is the difference?
Lots of questions are pouring, sir.
Not sure. Continue. If you have time, I don't mind.
Is pink salt is better than white salt?
Yeah, you see, this is a rock salt which is called pink salt, and there's so many types of salt, black salt and all, which they claim is. Rock salt may be better. There are no studies available because there are a lot of trace elements like potassium, etc. There is a black salt which has a lot of potassium. Potassium is useful for us. You know, fruits and vegetables help the way, that's how they reduce it. But sodium is there in these salts equally, in equal amount. So I would still say, don't add extra salt. That means we use it extra salt only three things. One is adding in the salad or sometimes in the curd, we should avoid over. Secondly, pickles too much, we should not take. Pickles have a lot of salt. This chutney and sauce, it is not visible, but there's a lot of salt in it. And all these food, which is processed, which is, you know, think, which is preserved for a long period, has to be in salt. So that should be avoided. We should take fresh fruits and vegetables, fresh vegetables, rather than, you know, preserved. It is frozen vegetables, which are, they have to be frozen in salt. So one should avoid things which have a lot of salt. So extra salt, but in the normal eating vegetables and in the other things like vegetables, etc., dal, you can have normal salt. So extra salt, if you can avoid it, that will cut down 25%, reduce, you see, by 25% heart disease. As I said, there's a WHO now, this slogan, reducing so 25% by 2025, to reduce heart disease by 25%. Salt, you see, no natural thing has salt, isn't it? When we said natural food, you should take, tell me which natural thing has salt. Nothing, isn't it? No vegetable, no fruits, etc. So, if we are not supposed to take too much of salt.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. आपने बहुत समय दिया.
Yes, sir.
और
any other question, I'm very happy, but you are most welcome. Yes.
ठीक है सर.
Can I make one last comment?
Yes, sir. You're most welcome, sir.
Sir, I think आपका lecture, आपका, मैं अपने बच्चों को तो दिखाऊंगा, students को. It should be a first year lecture for all medical students throughout India. The medical education should start from this lecture. This is the thing we need to do. हम लोग बहुत कुछ पढ़ा रहे हैं सर, मैं भी मेडिकल एजुकेशन में हूँ 30 साल से, बट वो नहीं पढ़ा रहे इवन प्रिवेंटिव में जो आप बता रहे हैं.
I agree, sir. I would add it up. Not only that, I think this in abbreviated form should be from the primary school.
Yes.
I go to school, I ask them. Do you eat junk food? They say yes. But why do you eat junk food? They don't know the reason. You see, this habit starts from the early childhood. You must have seen small children, our own grandchildren. They rush because the parents say, who get it from the fast food? Whatever. They are also responsible. I think it should be started from the nursery school, should go to schools, to colleges.
And yes, as sir, said, yes.
Of course, medical school, it should be a must.
क्योंकि डॉक्टर्स तो अपने को, आपने कहा ना, वो तो बचाएं अपने को पहले, तो इससे पहले वो हाईजैक हो जाएं बाय द हाई टेक एंड हाई एंड मेडिसिन, दे शुड बी प्राइम्ड. एंड आवर जॉब एज प्रिवेंटिव मेडिसिन, आई टेक इट ऑन मी एज फार एज पॉसिबल, आई विल स्प्रेड योर थॉट्स, आई एम ऑलरेडी डूइंग इट टू ऑल मेडिकल कॉलेजेस. ये लेक्चर आपका इतना बढ़िया है सर, मैं उनसे कहूंगा, रंजन जी से, मेरे को देंगे, मैं इसको पूरे अपने फ्रेंड्स में भेजूंगा. इट शुड बी अ लेक्चर, ओपनिंग लेक्चर फॉर अ मेडिकल स्टूडेंट. सो काइंड ऑफ यू सर.
वेरी सिंपल, सिंपल सॉर्ट ऑफ थिंग्स व्हिच आई वांटेड टू कन्वे, दैट्स
नो, वेरी नाइस, वेरी विद फुल ऑफ एविडेंस. एंड थैंक्स टू डॉक्टर रंजन, ही हैज अरेंज्ड सच अ ब्यूटीफुल लेक्चर. आई एम रियली ऑनर्ड एंड हैप्पी, एंड मेनी ऑफ माय कलीग्स विल थैंक मी व्हेन आई सेंड दिस लेक्चर टू देम.
थैंक यू. राइट,
थैंक यू सर. Thank you for your time and thank you for your wisdom.
Thank you. Thank you, Robin Bansal. It was really nice.
Thank you.
See you after a long time.
I am blessed to have your patronage.
You are doing a great job. I think your society is doing a great job. I can see.
No, sir. I'm just trying to follow myself and Dr. Ranjan, trying to follow stalwarts like you.
I think you are very right. If we follow holistic system, and that's the need of the hour, you see. The holistic thing is forgotten completely.
Yes.
Without that, we can't. You see, we do a good angioplasty, the patient still gets another heart attack. We do
a bypass, sir, yes.
And this is holistic system can take care of all that. You give statins, patients get a very low cholesterol, still gets a heart attack.
Yes, sir. Yes, that's true.
Statin can't take care of the stress, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes, that's true.
I think this is very important. You are right. It should be in medical schools from the very beginning.
It should be there. It is coming. It
will
coming.
Encourage people to have, you know, yoga is becoming very popular. And I hope that there is a yoga center in every hospital. Not given due importance in schools and so on and so forth. That will make the children much better citizens, you see.
Yes.
Not only in studies, but otherwise also. I mean, after all, why this? These are negative emotions which are causing this.
Yes, sir.
Hatred, ego, jealousy, lust. All society's problems are because of these bad emotions.
We are living
at a lower level of mind.
We have
to go to higher level, and yoga takes that is intellect. So we are living at a lower mind. We should go to higher mind. And this is exactly the moment we do that. I think problems are solved.
Yes.
Doctors have a lot of ego. You know that you are
yourself. That's true.
The moment you say that, you become the problem. You get disease. Chances of getting disease. So I think the doctors, as you said, have to become examples. They have to become role models. Unfortunately, we are not.
We are not. The higher the degree, higher is the ego. That is normally the scene.
Secondly,
but very, very few like you.
As
very
a teacher, I am disheartened. You see, when they say doctors are dishonest, they have taken so much extra money, they have done unnecessary angioplasty. So this hurts me because this is not the fault of the doctors. They don't know how to control lust, the greed,
which is a
quality of the lower mind.
At a very
lower level of their mind, the mind can achieve great heights.
Yes,
you can become a superman, as I call it. Dr. Nagendra says, from man to superman.
You are already a superman, sir.
I'm an ordinary human being, but the question is, we should try to convey people like you are doing a great job. Yeah. I'm, of course, still teaching postgraduate, but in that I mix up all this. I am a teacher, cardiologist, and that I like to continue. But I think with that, I try to mix up. I said, you may be the topmost cardiologist, you may be earning maximum, but be a good human being.
Yes, that's true.
You should say you are a good man, that's all.
Yes.
People say that you take a lot of money and all. Sometimes they call you dishonest. That hurts me.
Yes.
Then you are working at a lower level. I think this will take all problems from the school level, from the medical school level, and so on and so on.
Good. Yes.
That's a great idea. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, friends. Thank you for connecting with us. My participants bhi support system hote hain. Aap judte hain. To aap hamari motivation bante hain har bar, har Sunday session karne ke liye. Aur har Sunday hamara ye program 11 baje aata hai. Every Sunday we invite one doctor or one expert.